What's going on, everybody? It's Afro Think Tank. Today, I want to talk about Pan-Africanism and tribalism and how Pan-Africanism is going to defeat tribalism. Let me explain. Now that black people are starting to communicate with each other, black people who don't know each other, who only seen each other through the eyes of European white Western media, white media, they're now starting to get together and talk on platforms. One of the best platforms where you can find a bunch of black people from different parts of the world is Afro Millennials channel. I recommend you go subscribe to her channel because she opens up a forum for everybody around the diaspora to just come on there and talk about various issues. So check her out, African Millennial. But what I've noticed on her show sometimes, and this is good that we're seeing this now, it's good that it's being made aware, is that what we see about this FBA thing that we see in America with African Americans becoming tribalistic when encountering other Africans from other parts of the world, what we think is something uniquely xenophobic in America is actually consistent with the way Africans have been acting for the last few hundred years. Before the Western world came along and destabilized the continent of Africa, us African people understood and knew that we were different. Even though we all are black, we're all African, we're all of the continent, we all understood that we're different. We traded and we warred with each other just like everybody else around the world. We conquered, we did bad things, we did our own form of genocide. We collaborated, we traded, we married, we merged, we separated. We did the same thing every other group did. But what makes things different is we live in a land of abundance. Our continent is a land of abundance. And most of the world is not as fortunate in us to have the abundance that we have. So we didn't have to fight for necessarily for the same resources like everybody else. So inherently we're not as vicious and we didn't develop some of the nasty, vicious skills necessary to do the things that the European has done to us. That itself was foreign to us. So when the foreigner came, and during the Berlin Conference, when the Europeans divided Africa up, they did it knowing full well that they would cause so hate and division. You see, African people, even though we knew we were different, we had different tribes, different ethnicities, we worked together, we fought together, just like any human being, any group of people. When the Europeans left, they had a scorched earth policy, right? So they divided the continents up, and they put tribes together with groups that would otherwise would have left each other alone or had enough buffer space to quell conflict. Okay, they also put tribes, certain tribes that were hostile, put them in charge because they knew that that particular tribe would be irresponsible when it came to leadership. They made sure certain tribes that had certain strength that they weren't maximized, that they were basically null and void. And this is consistent with the way Europeans have operated throughout the world. They've done the same thing to Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh. That's why you see Pakistan and India right now. They're at odds. Why? Because there's a border dispute. Why? Who created that border? A white man came, drew it, purposefully left Bangladesh out so that they could fight over Bangladesh and various other disputed parts of the divide line between the two countries. Because Pakistan and India used to be one country. They did the same thing in China when they created Hong Kong. Hong Kong became a democratic system for 100 years. They had a and then when they finally gave it back to China, which is a communist country, authoritarian country, they knew that those two different cultures would clash. You're talking about 100 years of these people in Hong Kong living a certain way, a certain lifetime. That means the generation after them, that means a couple generations in, they knew nothing of the main body of China. They weren't even the same people. They weren't even the same culture. That's why you see China trying to reabsorb Hong Kong back into the society. That's why you see unrest in the streets right now. It's a form of division, divide and conquer. You must understand the concept because if you don't, you'll realize we are also stuck in that same trap. Africans, consistently, Africans knew one thing. We knew that we didn't own land. We were a part of the land. So we never, the concept of staking land for ourselves was foreign to us. We knew we had a certain territory, but we didn't inherently believe that we owned the land underneath of, but that's the land that the spirits allowed us to live on. Europeans have a thing where they believe they can own land, earth. They can literally purchase land. And they brought that concept to America and created these things called countries. We didn't necessarily need countries. We had empires. Our tribes, our groups moved with nature, meaning if it's more fertile out here, over here, we moved over here. If it was more fertile over here, we moved over here. Our cities picked up and moved. But then we established ourselves, we established trade, so we wouldn't have to pick up and move, but we can get food and sustenance or whatever we needed from various different places. But at the same time, we had our tribe was our group, our tribe was our state, our tribe was our city, our tribe was our country. That's the concept at which Africans live, right? So when you bring a new concept of state, you all of a sudden have a tribe and another tribe in the same state, and you're telling them, hey, you're the same people. And the problem is, a lot of these tribes that are being forced together, they weren't put together through mutual benefit. They didn't discuss between each other, hey, we're going to be together. They were forced together. And some of those tribes were forced together, and they were warring with each other at the same time. Some of these tribes were mortal enemies, and they were forced and told that you're now one people. Now tell me, how does that work out? They never had the time to hash out their differences, because throughout all this chaos, they were still being taken advantage of and attacked by the European. And if you think it was the European and the white man that came in with their muskets and shot and killed and destroyed a bunch of Africans with spears and shields, you're sadly mistaken. The European does not fight their own fights when it comes to foreigners. What they do is they'll take one tribe, a small tribe that maybe was being taken advantage of by a big tribe. They take that small tribe, give them a bunch of guns, give them all the ammunition and the cannons, and they'll take a small brigade of Europeans to manage and assist them, and that tribe would be the one to go attack the bigger tribe with their weapons. Because if you're a smaller tribe, of course you're going to accept those weapons to defeat a bigger tribe that's been, giving you problems, right? That sows more hate and division between that tribe. Then what you do is, when the Europeans leave for neo-colonialization, they take the tribe they know they can control. And then they give them the power, the resources, and the governorship over everybody else. That will also create more hate and division. And what I've noticed is nowadays, now that we're in the age of information, these cities are made, countries are built, the borders are there. There's nothing we can technically do about it at this present moment. We have to deal with what we have. But what I notice is, there's a lot of Africans on the continent that's displayed exactly the same xenophobia as our FBA brethren over here. Is actually consistent with the same low way of thinking that we have going on the continent. I listen to Ethiopians and Somalians go back and forth disrespecting each other about their culture, when in fact they're pretty much the same group of people who've been through pretty much the same struggle, various differences via neo-colonialization and various other outside influences that caused them to be in the situation that they are in today. And the problem is, what we're doing is we're fighting over the disease. We're fighting over the pain. We're fighting over things that are not beneficial or not tangible for the future. You see, we're not fighting about the cause. We're not looking at the root cause of why all these things are going on. I hear Ethiopians disrespecting Somalians. I hear Somalians disrespecting African Americans. I hear African Americans disrespecting Nigerians. I hear Ghana's disrespecting Nigerians. I hear Nigerians disrespecting African Americans. I hear everybody has an ego. Everybody believes that their African group is the biggest African group, that their African group is the toughest African group, that their African tribe is the most badass African tribe, and every other tribe need to look at their tribe because their tribe got it going on. But in real life, we all got issues. We all got problems. And what we need to do is get past the little petty things about why is it that we fail? Why is it that our countries look this way? Why is it that we have these problems? The thing is, we already know the answer to that, and it's time to move the conversation forward. We know who the root cause of all our division is. We know who the problem. We're not pointing our attention to the real culprit. Instead, we're fighting each other. Instead, we're battling each other. Instead, we're saying, who got hurt the worst? Who's the biggest victim? Right? Who this? Who that? Right? And then we spit all our venom and hate towards each other. And as long as we do that, the Western world, the European world, they're going to sit back, watch, be entertained, and laugh, because they know as long as we continue to fight each other, they don't have nothing to worry about. As long as Ethiopians, Eritreans, Somalis, Ghana, Nigeria, Kenyans, South Africans, African Americans, as long as our tribes continue to fight each other, we're distracted. And while we're distracted, guess who's coming to take our resources? The white man, the European, the Asian. Yeah. Because the thing is, we put so much value on these foreigners, just like we put value on their religion. We put value on their items, their clothes. We put value on their things, right? So when a white man comes into your country, goes into your countryside, digs up your minerals and destroys your ecosystem, you don't have a problem with that. When an Asian person comes to your country, ties up your financial institutions and then starts to buy your major natural resources and they own it, you don't have a problem with that. When a Lebanese come into your neighborhoods, build grocery stores, hire other Lebanese people and just sell you goods, but not one Nigerian works in that shop or not one African works in that shop and they disrespecting your people on a daily basis, you don't have a problem with that. But when an African-American or another African from another country brings up a problem in your country that needs to be fixed, all of a sudden you have a lot of smoke and a lot of venom for that person. You got a lot of hate and a lot of animosity for that person, but you don't have animosity for the actual perpetrators of your downfall. You don't have any animosity for the perpetrators of your country's lack of development. You don't have any animosity for the person that's really hostile towards your country. You don't. Because nobody's looking at the bigger picture. Everybody's looking at the small picture. They got tunnel vision, right? You don't see the big picture. You don't see the enemy from outside. You don't see from outside of your house because you're too busy fighting your brother and your sister. While the white man's outside lighting a fire and your house is on fire. But you don't care because you're fighting with your brother and sister over stupid stuff inside the room. Before you know it, you're all going to die. So this is the thing. It doesn't matter how you feel about someone. Feelings doesn't matter. It's about reality and what's actually happening. No matter how much a Somali wants to fight an Ethiopian or Ethiopian thinks the African Americans are this and that, no matter what you've seen on TV or what you believe or what you saw, guess what? The white man and the Asian is coming for your resource and they want it and they're going to get it because you're not paying attention. Your best ally is the one that's next to you. Your best ally is the one that you have the most commonality with. Your best ally is a person that looks like you. Your best ally who is a person who have the same interests as you, maintaining their country, developing infrastructure, and thriving economically. Africans should be trading with Africans. Africans should be able to easily travel between African countries. Africa should look at Europe and see the example how they said after they got fat off the milk and honey of Africa, they developed their nations, even though them themselves are not united. As you can see, they have consistently been fighting and killing each other. They've never stopped. So they're only united economically and socially in certain aspects, but they are not united. Understand the fact that they're not united means that there is a door opening for us to unite and fix our problems, because right now they're distracted with their own issues that they have over there. And right now, we need to be taking advantage of that situation and getting our house in order because their house is on fire. Because the method of which they wanted to rule the world is not sustainable and it's backfiring on them. Their chickens are coming home to roost. All right. So while that's happening, we need to lower our egos because we have egos. All black people have egos. All of us. We're all egotistical, emotional creatures. Very. Our emotional aspect is beyond everybody else in the world. We feel, I believe we actually feel more and we're more mature with our emotions, but we don't know how to control our emotions. Our means of communication is far superior than anybody else. Our ability to communicate is far superior than anybody else, but we have lost the knowledge of what we have as power, as black people, as Africans, our power. We've been here for hundreds of thousands of years on this planet before they even existed. We've been doing this for quite a while. We slipped up just recently and we lost ourselves. Now we need to find ourselves. The xenophobia has to end. And you know what Pan-African offers? Pan-Africanism offers a space for people who don't want to be xenophobic. Pan-Africanism basically says, hey, for the people that want to do business with me, for the people that want to socially connect economically with me, for the people who want to connect socially with me. So what that means is, as a Pan-African-American, I'm a Pan-African and I'm an African-American. That means I don't care if someone from Nigeria has a problem with an African-American. That's his problem because I love Nigeria and I love Nigerian people and I'm willing to work with the Nigerian people that want to work with me. And that means my army gets just a little bit bigger, right? I don't care if there's a Ghanaian who don't like Nigerians and African-Americans because they think we show off too much or whatever. I don't care. That's that guy's problem. I want to work with the Ghanaian who sees me as a brother and an asset and wants to join my army, my Pan-African army. That makes my army a little bit bigger, right? I don't care about the Somali who wants to call himself Arab or whatever, and wants to disassociate himself with the rest of Africa and African Americans who think we're a bunch of vagabonds. I don't care about that guy. That's his problem. I want to work with the Somali to understand he's black and he's a part of the African community, and he wants to work with me as an African American. I don't care about the Kenyan who think he's better than everybody else in East Africa and better than African Americans because they're real Africans. I don't care about that guy. That guy has an issue. I want to work with the Kenyan that believes that we're all brothers and that we can work together socially, economically. Why? Because that makes my army bigger. And what's going to happen is these xenophobic armies, they're going to get smaller and smaller and smaller because I'm going to keep grabbing every person that wants to work with me. The Pan-African army is going to be bigger than the xenophobic army. The Pan-African army is going to be bigger than the separatist army. I don't care if South Africans, if there's a group of South Africans that look at me and call me a color and try to tell me I'm not African. I don't care about that person because to me they're delusional and they're sick and that's their problem. I want to work with the South African that look at me as an African brother and that want to do things with me socially, economically. Because guess what? My army just got bigger. Pan-African, the pan, is about all of us. You see, back in the days when people used to conquer other countries, it's not like it was a million people that would walk into a country with a million people and just take over with sheer number. No, it was a few people that had the ability to take action. It only took a couple hundred people to take over a country sometimes. It only took a couple thousand people to take over a country sometimes. Don't look at these European movies and think that it was tens of hundreds of thousands of Europeans and swords and shit, and they would just go ransacking through a country because they had overwhelming numbers. No, because the majority of people don't do anything and they're docile. It only takes a few people who's willing to take action, and the majority of people will bend the knee. You understand? So what's going to happen is when the Pan-African movement starts to come out, you see, the Pan-African music is a conglomerate of African people around the world who want to connect socially, economically, and understand that is we have to work together. And now that we're in the age of information, now people are starting to find out that Pan-Africanism is not just a bunch of YouTubers on an internet talking about Marcus Garvey. It's not just a nostalgia of what Marcus Garvey was doing. Marcus Garvey was one small piece of the Pan-African movement. The Pan-African music movement consists of African presidents, dignitaries, non-governmental entities, African Union. We're part of the sixth region. If you're an African American, you're a descendant of slaves, you are represented in the African Union as the sixth region of the African Union. We all have representation. We have real Pan-Africanism has created real African representation for the African American that was taken into the transatlantic slave trade. That is a real thing, a real tangible thing that will bear fruit in the future once these systems get placed in order, once other parts of this organization matures and becomes more organized. It takes time. Nothing happens overnight. But understand the Pan-African movement is literally the only movement that's fighting against this xenophobia. You got the EFF in South Africa, probably one of the most inspirational movements they got going on over there is that EFF movement. Take example from them guys right there. They're a small organization, but they're getting bigger and bigger, and they're growing power in South Africa. And one day soon, they will take over in South Africa as their message grows and becomes bigger and bigger, and as their army grows and becomes bigger and bigger. And when that happens, in various other countries, it will spread. Because one thing about African people is when one group of African does something and is successful and everybody sees it, we copy. We're copycats. That's what we do. We copy each other. And that's one good aspect about being black, is we copy each other. I want y'all to understand that African Americans are the example of what happens when an African people can unify. Because remember, African Americans are a combination of Africans who once warred, fought, enslaved, enslaved each other, brought over here by the wicked Europeans through their capitalistic system of the transatlantic slave trade, and we were forced to unite over here under duress. So every accomplishment that an African American made, everything that an African American invented, everything that you see and admire about an African American as an African, as a West and Central and South African mostly, and some East African, you can be proud that those are your people who done that thing over there under duress. So you can take credit for what it is the African Americans do because we are your brothers. And we know the origin of our power is Africa. So when you say you're black, you're saying you're African. So if you hear somebody who's being xenophobic as an African American to try to separate themselves by saying black, understand they're just stupid and retarded, and that's their problem. That's not the sentiment of the overall body of African Americans, because most African Americans are proud to be African. That's why we like to say African American. When we put our hand up and we say black, we understand what that means. That's black from Africa. You see these colors I'm wearing? We understand this. We know what this means. This is black from Africa. That's the source of our pride. It's our Africanness that gave us the intelligence to build and invent such great things that make the Western world so great. It's the Africanness that gives us intelligence to excel in school. That's why when you see these Nigerians come over here, why do they excel? They excel the same way we excel because we are Nigerian. African Americans are basically Nigerian. And if you do any type of historical research, you will understand that the majority of African Americans are basically just Nigerians a few hundred years removed. So that means we share the same DNA, the same intellect, the same capability, the same motivation, the same inspiration, the same go-getter attitude. We even look the same. Most of us are Igbos, Yorubas, Akans from Ghana. Remember, there was a time when there was no such thing as Ghana and Nigeria, Benin, and Togo. Take those lines away. These were one or two or three or four vast empires that worked and cooperated with each other economically, married between each other, and did all sorts of things like that. We were one melting pot of black, beautiful, intelligent Africans. That's what we were. And we can get all that back. But it's the tribalism issue that's the problem. We have to educate those who want to be educated and bring them into this Pan-African movement, because it's the only way we're going to survive. It's the only way we're going to get where we want to go. We can't keep complaining and begging the white man to give us anything. Just look at history. History should tell you that they're never going to give anything back that they've taken. The only way to get it back is to take it ourselves. And the only way to take it ourselves is to create institutions in Africa so powerful that African countries have enough power to sanction the Western world when they do their citizens wrong overseas, point blank and period. We have to become so powerful that the Western world is afraid to do anything to the citizens of those countries. So we have to go home. We have to build. We have to connect. We have to create institutions so strong, so powerful, so influential. We need to control our economy, control our market, trade with each other. I should be able to go tonight, fly to Nigeria and get on a train, and I should be able to go all around Africa. There should be a train system that can take me to every country in Africa. I should be able to get on it. There should be a road where I can go all up and down the West African coast. And those things are being built right now, whether a lot of people know it or not. The train systems are also being built right now, whether people know it or not. It should be moving faster and it should be highlighted more. Politicians are getting better, even though that's not really being highlighted, because the overwhelming level of corruption is what's highlighted in Africa, because everybody likes to highlight the bad things that happen in Africa and they never talk about the good things that happen in Africa, because then that's the narrative the Europeans want to continue to pump into the Western system to tell everybody outside of Africa that Africa is still a horrible place to be, while they simultaneously try to take everything they can from Africa. So we just need to raise the level of our own intelligence. African Americans, we need to raise the level of our own intelligence and awareness about what's happening in the continent, period. So we can take advantage of the opportunities that's there for us to take without being inhibited by the Europeans and their institutionalized discrimination within their own systems that keep us down or make things harder for us when we try to rise. Because it's not like we can't do things here. It's just that they make it very difficult for us to do it. And we have to work really, 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 really hard to get past all those little things they've placed within the institutions that we try to excel in. If you go to Africa, the only issue you're going to have is your plane ticket and your visa and maybe a language barrier depending on which country you pick. But once you get there, you'll understand that facilitating your business will be a lot easier, smoother without red tape there. So Pan-Africanism is literally the only way. Everything else is a joke. That pretendian, that's a joke. That's mental illness within our community. That's mental illness. Just like the various other groups and clubs, religious little organizations we create, that's all mental illness. We're still holding on to the white man's religion. We're still holding on to the Asian man religion. We do not embrace and we still believe that the African religions are inherently evil because that's been programmed into us. Understand there's a programming in your head that you need to deprogram. You need a hard reboot. You need to reset this. And you need to download, you need to update and download your mind. And I know it's hard to accept new information. It's hard to take the information that you believe to be true and to believe that it's fake. To believe that your thought process your whole life has been wrong. It's hard to accept it and understand that. But that's what we have to do if you want to move forward. If not, we're just going to be sitting here stagnant in the same place. or we're going to be moving even slower towards progress, giving the Europeans an opportunity to figure out a new way to keep us down. Because keep in mind, the power dynamic in the world is changing and is shifting towards Africa. Do you want to be a part of that? Do you want your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren to be a part of the greatness of their own continent? Or do you want to be left on the outside wishing and hoping, praying and begging? It's your choice. Your life is the sum total of your decisions. What kind of decision are you going to make? It's Afro Think Tank. Learn something, teach something.
You're listening to DJ Afro Think Tank. Thanks for watching. Like, share, comment, and subscribe.